Thank you. Thank you for inviting me. It's a pleasure to come to Paris every time. I admit when I was planning my talk, I was looking forward to using a real blackboard. And nowadays, if you go to England, you see that there are hardly any real blackboards. Everything is a whiteboard. So here it is again. And so you should be careful with these. Don't let them proliferate.
No, this is where they screw whiteboards to blackboards in the world.
Yes. So let's start. Just because my talk is about words, I will need some notation. So first of all, let's start with profinite groups. So let G be a profinite group. Okay. And what is a profinite group? It's an inverse limit of a inverse system of finite groups, right? So we have a collection of finite groups with surjective homomorphisms onto each one. And then G is just the inverse limit of this system, yeah? Okay. And I will reserve the letter G for the profinite groups, and I will reserve the letter gamma will be one of the collection. This is better. Yeah. Thank you. So gamma will be really a finite group, which will be a topological finite image of the profinite group G. Okay. Now about words. Words are just elements in a free group. And if I have a word in S variables, that will be the free element of the free group on S letters, x1 up to xs. For group G, the word values, I will denote by G sub W. So that's the collection of all values of the word. Let's now call it x. And I also want to invert them, just not to bother about inverses. So the set of word values is just the values of the word. And the verbal subgroup, W of G, is the group generated abstractly by the set of word values. Okay. Now, why are we interested in this? Why are we interested in word values in profinite groups? Well, for me, the interest comes from the following question, a well-known question of Serre, which asked, that's a question by Serre. Suppose that G is finitely generated profinite group. What does it mean for G to be finitely generated, by the way? It means that G is finitely generated means that G is the closure of some elements, finitely many elements, yeah? G elements. The topological closure of the group that they generate. And that's the same as saying that each of these gamma I's can be generated by G elements. For the same D, yeah?
In a compatible way?
No, it doesn't have to be a compatible way. It could be, as long as it's in any way, then you can, by compactness argument, you can actually extract the D generators of it. Okay? And then Serre's question is the following. Well, because G is a, another way to define G is as a compact Hausdorff totally disconnected group. And then if you have an open subgroup of a compact group, it must have finite index. And Serre asked, is this true, or is the converse of this true? So suppose that H is a subgroup of finite index in G. So I denote by sub F the fact that H has finite index. Is it true that H is open. Now, there's a story to this question. In his book on Galago homology, Serre actually proved as an exercise that the answer is yes for prop groups, finitely generated prop groups. And he made a remark whether this could be true in general for profinite groups. And then some partial answers were obtained by a succession of people. And then to cut the story short, with Dan Siegel in 2002, we answered the answer is yes. And this motivates my talk. How did we answer? How did we find the answer? What we do is actually we find. So if you have this subgroup of finite index, find a word W, right, such that first of all, the verbal subgroup is inside H, and the second thing is that the verbal subgroup itself is open. If you do that, of course, H will be open because it will contain an open subgroup, right? Now, what is good about this is now for verbal subgroup, we have a following basic lemma, which I also want. It's one of these lemmas that really make the subject interesting. Is the following. For a word W, the following are equivalent. The following are equivalent. So G is a profinite group, W is a word. So the following equivalent, first, is that W of G is a closed subgroup. Okay. Second, is that exists some number N, which depends on W maybe, and G of course. W and G. Such that if I look at any of these finite images, of the topological images, and if I look at the verbal subgroup inside this finite group, this itself will be a product of just this n copies of word values. Right? Right? So we look at the elements of gamma, which are a product of word values. And it turns out that all of them actually product of just n word values. Yeah, and this is for all gamma in this family gamma I. Yeah. And the third condition is, of course, the basically saying the same for G. So exists n, in fact, the same n, such that the verbal subgroup of G is actually product of GW n times. Okay. And it's one of these lemmas that are relatively it's not hard to prove. Many directions are entirely obvious, right? Certainly C implies A because the set of word values after all is closed. Product of closed sets is closed. So C definitely implies A. Of course C implies B. And the non-trivial direction that closure of the verbal subgroup implies this boundedness of the width of the word really is an application of bare category theorem. Okay, but you see now we have this criterion. We can tell that something is closed by actually looking proving results about finite groups and expressing word product of word values as a just short products. Yeah. Okay. So, so what's the best result we could prove? Let me just summarize my result with Dan Siegel. The first thing we actually proved is with Dan Siegel we proved a theorem for commutators. We proved that for any finitely generated profinite group, the if W is the commutator word, x1 commutator x2, then the derived subgroup is closed. Okay? And actually, we proved more. So we have the following two results. So again, G is finitely generated profinite group. And W is a word. Let me make G degenerated. Generated by G elements. The first result is that if I take the free group on D letters and I consider the quotient by the verbal subgroup generated by W, so this is the free degenerated groups defined by the law W. If this one happens to be nilpotent, then certainly the verbal subgroup of G is closed in G. Yeah? So example of where this easily happens is if W itself is the commutator word, right? Then this is actually the free abelian group. Or if W is the n time iterated commutator law. Okay. And secondly, we had a lot of intermediate results which proved the positive answer here for specific words W. But all the time we were looking at for the simple word x to the n. Yeah? And in the end, several years ago, we proved that now if W is the word x1 to the power n for some integer n, then W of G, of course, this is actually just G to the n. That's my notation. G to the n is the group generated by n powers, is closed and in fact open. And so open in G. The reason I state it like that is because we really prove that it's closed. Okay, and then the fact that it's open follows by another deep theorem. Namely, the solution of the restricted Bernstein problem by Zelmanov. Okay. Okay, and then of course that word will do the job here. Yeah. Okay. Right. One can ask the question: for what words is this statement? Is this conclusion true? For what words is it always true that the verbal subgroup is closed in G? And that seems to be a very hard question. And here I should mention the result of Andrei Haikin. Who obtained a complete classification when G is a finitely generated pro P group. So if G is pro P, finitely generated, then the condition WG is closed in all such G is really the same as saying that the word is outside the second derived subgroup of the free group times the pth powers, the group generated by pth powers of the derived subgroup. Okay? So that's very explicit characterization of words in the universe of pro P groups. Yeah, it's the best possible result. But for profinite groups, we have no idea, and we don't even know it for angular words. Okay. Right. So this is just as a warm up, because this is all stuff that it's very difficult to make more progress for more words, I think. But what we can study is how about we relax this condition of finite generation here. Okay? Now, if you relax it too much, of course, nothing is true. So even the Serre's question is, let me actually just give a definition. Just so that we say that G is strongly complete if every finite index subgroup, every H of finite index UG is automatically open. Okay? That's the name for this condition. And if you remove, if you study this for finitely not finitely generated profinite groups, then it fails in a very spectacular fashion if you just suppose you just take G just to be the cyclic group of think of the vector space F2 with two elements, and take a Cartesian a product of countably many copies of F2, yeah, and then this has countably many open subgroups of index 2, but uncountably many subgroups of index 2, yeah, just by considering this as a vector space, right? So finite generation is essential, but maybe we can prove something for some families of groups, or maybe for some words, yeah. Let me just write a proposition here. Another proposition which indicates that in complete generality things can go badly even for word even for the verbal subgroup. Yeah. So in an abelian group, every verbal subgroup is after all closed because it's just the image of one verb value. Yeah. So this is not a counterexample that the verbal subgroup may not be closed. However, if you take any word and you take a word which is not silly, and silly means that the verbal subgroup on the free group is different from the free group of the identity, yeah? So the word will be silly if either the word is the identity word or if it's something, if the verbal subgroup is the whole free group, which can happen, for example, if you take a primitive word. But it can happen even if you don't take a primitive word, yeah? Okay, so if we remove these ones, then, of course, for those, the verbal subgroup always will be closed. Then exists a profinite group. G, such that W of G is not closed. G, yeah? So, so things break down really badly. I don't know if I have time to. I would like to.
For example, for commutator.
Oh, for commutator, this is even easier because how would you show this breaks down? Well, you're going to build. I raise my lemma here, but you're going to find finite groups. Which I say perfect. Every element is a product of commutators, but you need more and more commutators to write them down, and such families exist. Yeah, and in the same way, you can build a collection for any word which is not silly. You can actually find a collection of finite groups, which will have this property that they're equal, say, to their verbal subgroup, but you need more and more word values, and then take the Cartesian product of all of them. And that will fail the condition of the lemma.
So how about if you take, instead of F, the free pro P group, and then you look at a pro P G?
Right, okay, so I don't know. Here's an interesting question. That's how actually I was thinking. Can you make this example with G pronipotent? Yeah? Can you find G as above, which is pronipotent? Pronipotent simply means that it's an inverse limit of finite nilpotent groups. Yeah, I don't know. Right. So my talk will be trying to salvage something about from here. So we need to restrict either the words. This proposition says that if you cannot just restrict the words because for any word you can find a bad group, so we have to restrict the groups a little bit, yeah. Okay. Okay. So here are some results. First of all, remember result of Martin Liebeck and Tanner. This is now an old result, has been improved in many ways, but still it's very important because it Certainly, if you don't care about bounds, that's the result that you need. So it says that for any word exists some integer, depending on the word, such that if S is non-abelian simple group, finite simple group, then the verbal subgroup of S is equal to SW. Everything in the verbal subgroup is a product of bounded of n word values. Yeah, and in fact more is true. So later theorems proved by Aner, by Larsen, Tiep show that actually you can take n is 2. If the size of S is bigger than compared to some function of W, yeah. So given the word, if the simple group is big enough, then in fact this will be O of S, and then everything in S is a product of just two word values. Okay. So that's Larsen, Shalev, and I think Tiep, Aner should correct me if I'm missing. These are names I remember. I think Aner proved it with foot 3. Yeah. But now, certainly, in order to, if you just want to prove finite closure of the profinite group, you don't really care about the bound as long as one exists. Okay, so. How can we generalize this? Well, of course, if this is true, then of course it will be, since this is true, it will be true for any Cartesian product of finite simple, non-abelian finite simple groups, especially by looking at all the factors, right? And then that moves beyond finitely generated groups rather quickly, yeah? Because if you take a Cartesian product of one finite simple group many, many, many times, it will stop being generated by two elements, three elements, yeah? So let's say, so let's say let's call a profinite group G unabelian if finite groups that it's defined as an inverse limit, if these groups none of them have no abelian composition factors. Okay, so the group, if you look at it as an inverse limit of finite groups, none of them have abelian composition factors. Now this is a big restriction on a finite group. There's some results that say that in some way it resembles a Reed product. So examples. Of course, the trivial example is if I take S1 times S2, yeah, right, a Cartesian product of simple groups, yeah, excuse me, right, like that product SI with SI simple, or I can take Reed product, yeah, I take any permutational representation of any collection of finite simple groups, and just take the permutation of Reed product. Yeah. And for both of these, it's relatively easy to prove that the verbal subgroup is for any word is actually closed. And for these, actually, a verbal subgroup is always going to be open even. Yeah, it's an exercise.
Are these the only examples?
No, so that's actually an interesting story. I'll get to it now. The thing is, if you look at the structure of a finite group which has no abelian composition factors, then the product of the minimal normal subgroups is a Cartesian product of finite simple group. The action of the group on it is permuting the factors, and this action is faithful. But you can still have some twists in the permutation of the factors. You can still act by some automorphisms. Right. So, motivated by these examples, with uh, uh, my, my, I, I, with Anner and Martin Liebeck, we started thinking about these groups, and we really wanted to prove the following. So you've heard from Anner that the Ore conjecture is now proved for the finite simple group. So every element of the of a non-abelian finite simple group is a commutator. And a natural question is, so our question with that's Liebeck, me, and Shalev is the Ore conjecture for unabelian groups. So let G be unabelian. Is every element with the commutator. So we don't have a count example. We believe it's very likely this is true, but the proof breaks down. We actually thought that we had a proof. We even wrote a proof. We even wrote a paper, and then we found a mistake that we underestimated these unabelian groups that they have these nasty twists in their composition factors that. Require more work. What we can prove, though, is actually this is a result that really comes from my first paper with Dan Siegel. So it's really, I'll call it a proposition, because the proof is really very immediate from a proposition layer. Is that one can show that certainly if G is is unabelian. Then the derived subgroup. Is everything, yeah. So it's perfect, i.e. Every exists some number n such that if G is in that group, then G is a product of n commutators. So we cannot get it to one commutator, but we can certainly get it to boundedly many. Like n does not depend on anything. So this n actually I should say it's here. It does not depend on the group. It's just some absolute constant. But
not even on the rank of the group.
No. But it's a pretty big constant, my student Matthew Levy has been trying to kind of get it small, and he could get it small in some simple group. It involves computations in results about finite simple groups, and we believe it really should be one. Okay, so that's surprising, or maybe not, depending on how you look at it. Because after all, you can say, oh, these groups are very 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 restricted. Still. Even for them, there could be some surprises. So we were wondering, is it possible that for these unabelian groups, maybe every verbal subgroup is closed? Maybe there's nothing special about this case. Maybe whatever word you choose, the verbal subgroup will be closed, because this is the case here and this is the case here, right? Here, it doesn't matter which word you take. However, even for powers, so example, is that, there exists an abelian G such that the verbal subgroup obtained by the word x to the 30 is not closed. Right, so the word here is x to the 30. And this 30 is really comes because this is the exponent of A5. So in fact, any n which is the exponent of a finite simple group will do. Okay. Okay. So Let me. I want to finish with the questions and results, and maybe if I have time, I will mention how we, how we actually construct this. What else we can show? Perhaps this turns out that for some exponent, though, completely different things happen. So on the other hand, if and this is another proposition, but this one should be really a theorem. It requires more work. Now, if n is an odd integer and g is an abelian, then actually, again, g to the n is g. That's again the same as saying exists some number n, which in this case depends only on little n, such that every element in the abelian group is a product of capital N powers, powers of n. And what's the difference between this and this? And I should tell you immediately where does this come from. Well, it comes from the following fact about finite simple group. Okay, it says the following. So if S is finite simple group, which is not abelian, as usual, and if I take alpha on automorphism of S, and then if I look at the coset of alpha, at the coset of alpha modulo the inautomorphisms in the inside the automorphism group of the group, this is never equal to the identity in the automorphism group of S. Okay. So if n is odd. And of course, when alpha is the trivial element, the fact that the elements of S cannot all have order dividing n is simply because no finite simple group can have odd order. Right? It's a consequence of this theorem. Now, And results like that are needed for these theorems because of the possible action by automorphisms on the direct factor on the minimal normal subgroup of an unabelian finite group. Okay, so how far can we push this? We can. By the way, this actually is very close to the best possible because, to my surprise, it turned out that this exists now. If, on the other hand, here is another strange example that I didn't know. If n is a power of 2, right, then exists, I can take gamma or S to be the finite simple group PSL 2 over a finite field of size power of a power of 3 to the n, and a specific alpha. I can choose a specific alpha. Choose and not any automorphism, a specific automorphism, such that every element in this coset have order a power of 2. 2 to the n plus 2 will do. Right? So it's of course impossible for the for a finite simple group to have only elements of order powers of 2. But you can take a coset of it by an automorphism, and then all the elements in that coset have order power of 2. Yeah? And this is the reason we cannot generalize this beyond these odd numbers. Okay? as usual for these groups, the, if you fix the word, the problem is really a small group, finite simple groups, which actually satisfy this word as an identity, right? And they have only finitely many. So if we remove them, then everything is nice as it should be. So here is a theorem which says the following. Let W be any word. And then exists some number, k, depending on W, integer, with the following properties, such that if G is an abelian, and all composition factors aptors of images of gamma, basically one of these images of gamma have size at least k, then the verbal subgroup is equal to G. So if you remove these bad groups, well, for any word, there will be some finite collection of bad finite simple groups that we have to remove. And then if you do that, then the, no problem. Every verbal subgroup is close, and because we've removed so many of the composition factors, it's in fact equal to G. And what makes this work is the following theorem about coset identities, about finite simple groups. So it's an old theorem of Jones that there are only finitely many finite simple groups which can satisfy a given identity. So if I take a word, some finite simple groups can satisfy that word. For example, x to the 30 kills a5, right? But there will be only finitely many. And we have to generalize this to coset identities in the following way. So let W be a word, and then exists K. In fact, the same K that feeds into this theorem, with the following property, such that if S is finite simple group with size bigger than K, finite simple group, and then if I choose alpha 1, alpha 2, suppose the word is a word in x1, x2, xd, right? D variables. Then if I choose any d automorphisms, then this identity is not satisfied. This coset identity is not satisfied. So s alpha 1, S alpha 2, S alpha d is not 1 in the automorphism group of S. Okay. In other words, I can choose a representative for the coset of alpha 1 mod the inner automorphisms, of a representative for alpha 2 and representative for alpha d, such that when I evaluate the word on the on these representatives, I don't get the identity. Yeah? That's provided the size of the group is big enough. Right? So this is the necessary ingredient to feed into this theorem, yeah? To eliminate this possibility. Okay, so this is my alarm saying that I only have 5 minutes. Now, at the end, I want to mention another direction that we have been thinking. So remember, G was called strongly complete if every finite index subgroup was open. And so far, the only reason we can prove that finite index, the groups are strongly complete is because we actually prove that if n is an integer, then the group generated by n powers is open in G, yeah? And of course, if for any n, if you prove that, then that implies that G is strongly complete. Okay. So that's a trivial statement almost. But that's the only way that we have really been proving that groups are strongly complete. Okay, maybe not for these words, but eventually we for finitely generated profinite groups, that's what happened. Yeah, this was open, and so G is strongly complete. So the question is there any chance that the converse could be true? The converse. In other words, if G is strongly complete, okay, I'm not going to write down because it's clear, right? If G is strongly complete, does it mean that G to the N is open in OG? Right? Now, I have to say here that actually G strongly complete is equivalent to some verbal property. So G strongly complete actually, this is a result of John Wilson. John Wilson. This is equivalent to saying that for any group, for any finite group gamma, if I take, let me call it V, be a word, which is a base for all the laws, which is a base or generator for all laws of gamma. Remember by a theorem of Oates and Powell in Ushansky's talk, there exists such a word. Yeah, this is generated by a single word. And for this word, the verbal subgroup of G is open. So John, I think I quote correctly your result.
Me and Mike Smith.
Ah, okay, thank you. Okay. So being strongly complete is really equivalent to a statement about verbal subgroups. Yeah? And here we have G to the N instead of these mysterious, but these words are quite mysterious. Yeah? So this question, the converse, is really asking what is the relationship between verbal subgroup for these mysterious words and the verbal subgroups given by the power words. Yeah. So by this comparison, it probably suggests it's probably a hard question because it's usually difficult to distinguish between different words which are so closely which are so closely related. So. What is certainly true is that if G is strongly complete, then this group is its closure is definitely open. That's something that Dan Siegel proved, okay, and that already is not quite trivial. It needs the whole Higman theory of finite groups of finite exponent. And one reason to study these unabelian groups is try to at least investigate this converse for unabelian groups, but we still don't have it. Yes. Okay, I think my time is up, so I'll stop. Thank you.
Thank you very much, Nick. Are there any questions or comments?
Will your results depend on the classification of finite groups?
Yes. Which one? Okay. The only one that doesn't depend is this proposition that I wrote that for any word that for any non-silly word there exists a profinite group for which the subgroup verbal subgroup is not closed. For that one, you don't need the classification. But all these results, which
they depend in the Greek sense, right? The results continue to be true for all groups whose
yes. And they also won't be affected if they are only finitely many undiscovered finite simple groups. So.
But the result of Jones you mentioned doesn't depend on the classification.
Oh, no, no, it does depend on the classification.
It does.
Can you say a few words about the the example of non-abelian G such that G to the third is not closed.
Right, okay, so this, yes. This is the... Now, this one actually is very simple. What we do is the following. You take a group which does not satisfy x to the 30. So for example, you can take s to be a 6, yeah? And then certainly s to the 30 is still s, right? Because, and then you take a big Cartesian power. So let now L be s times s times s, a direct product of many copies of s, yeah? So, or many, yeah? N, okay? And what you're making sure is that this group is not, and make choose n big enough, so this one is not, say, degenerated. Okay, so we start with a given d. Okay? So make sure that this group is not degenerated. And then what we do, we enumerate all degenerated subgroups of L. So let script A be the collection of all m subgroups of L such that m is degenerated. Okay. And then we consider, for each such m, we consider a very simple group, which is basically just write, let me call it W, maybe W is a bad letter, V sub M. This is just A5. A5 is going to turn up at some stage, of course, to the power omega, where omega M is just the coset space. Omega M is just L mod M. Yeah. So this is just the transitive permutation action of L on its cosets, and then using this transitive action, we consider this this as a G group as a group by group acted on by L, okay, and then we form the group. Let me call it delta M. I started with an integer d, actually. So delta d is going to be the product of all these VMs for all the degenerated subgroups. Same direct product with the action of L. Okay. And okay, this is the definition. And the claim is that in this group, in that group still, every element is a product of 30 powers of other elements. But in this group, there exists an element which is not a product of less than d 30 powers of elements. Okay, this needs a little bit of work, but basically the idea of taking degenerated subgroups here is essential. Yeah. And then, of course, if you have this for all d, you just take the Cartesian product of all of them. Yeah. Sorry.